Morning, Bob. And welcome to everyone here. We want to extend a special welcome to anyone who is visiting with us for the very first time on this beautiful, crisp fall morning. It is almost October. I have to remind myself that it is almost October. Welcome. If you are visiting with us for the very first time, please notice that there is a flap on the side of your bulletin, and we would greatly appreciate it if you would complete that and drop it in one of the offering boxes at the end of the service. There is one in the back under the clock and another out in the foyer. Just a couple of reminders this morning. Our luncheon and semi-annual church business meeting will be directly after the service today. Everyone is welcome and invited. There will be food. If you are a member of the church, we do specially ask you to attend because there will be some voting going on and we need your votes. Also, please notice that the family movie night has been rescheduled to October the 4th. And finally, a new thing in the bulletin, Ladies Night Out, Thursday, October the 22nd. This is a part of the Iron Sharpens Iron Ministry. So that's the Thursday before the Saturday presentation. So if you're tied up on Saturday and you'd like to have some good fellowship and hear some good sharing, that would be something to consider. It's up in Bloomfield. And one of the speakers is the woman that played, I think her name was Miss Clara, in the War Room movie. She will be one of the speakers. Okay, if you will rise with me, we will consider God's word.
Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first produce of your entire harvest. Then your barns will be completely filled and your vats will overflow with new wine.
Heavenly Father, we thank you and we remember that everything that we have because of your gracious, lavish love towards us, Lord God. Our possessions, Lord, and our redemption through your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, help us to remember these things. Help us to remember that you only ask for one-tenth back of everything you've given us, and we have it only because of your love. Help us to remember also and appreciate the great gift that you have given us in our salvation through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray that our worship here this morning would be pleasing in your sight, and we thank you for this opportunity. In Jesus' name, amen.
This morning, our music worship is going to be focusing on, Bob has been talking about last week, was on trust and wisdom of the Lord. And there are so many things that are going on in our lives, but we have no clue of all the battles going on in the spiritual realms that we have victory in because of the Lord Jesus Christ, because of him and his power. And we have to trust him because he knows what's going on even when we don't. And yet he knows us all individually, very personally, and because of that and all that he does for us, that is why we need to worship him and lay ourselves down before him. So join us as we begin with There's Power in the Blood.
Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can for sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not the good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and peace, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow.
Fashioned against us this will stand. The battle belongs to the Lord, and we sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Darkness comes in like a flood. The battle belongs to the Lord. He's raised up a standard, the power of his blood. The battle belongs to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. We sing glory. Fear. The battle belongs to the Lord. Take courage, my friend, your redemption is near. The battle belongs to the Lord, and we sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. Power and strength to the Lord.
Scriptures say, let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and for his wonderful deeds for men. Let me just open it up to the floor. Maybe some of you would like to just publicly give thanks in prayer for God's unfailing love.
This congregation. Thank you for all that you have given us. We live in a time of turmoil and uncertainty. But Lord, we can look to your words in Holy Scripture and find solace there. We pray that you will be with us, Lord, and comfort us in our time of need. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Amen.
The scriptures say, For he breaks down the gates of bronze and cuts through the bars of iron. Some become fools through their rebellious ways and suffer affliction because of their iniquities. We're told that they loathed all food and they drew near the gates of death, and they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress. He sent forth his word and he healed them. He rescued them from the grave. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for men. Let's sing that last song again, for we have a maker.
Here I am to worship, here I am to bow.
Father, we come before you to worship you because you are the great King. You are the Almighty God. You are the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega. And so we give you thanks and praise and glory and honor in Christ's name. Amen. I'm going to ask Children's Church to go ahead and be seated. Be dismissed. Never fails. There's always something, you know? There's a cross to bear when you put this microphone on. You know, I'll never forget, this is just a complete side note. I know I've told you this, but my dad told me to go to business school because he wanted me to learn how to mind my own business. And my mom always wanted me to be a comedian. So anyway, here I am. So now how do I recover from this? Well, I do want to look into God's word today briefly. We don't have special music, just to kind of shorten the day a little bit for you here. Unless somebody wants to sing, we can accommodate that. I think, John McCall, did you want to sing? Did you want to sing a solo? No. Okay. So we'll spare you from me singing. I won't step in and sing. But I do want to look a little bit more into God's word today, especially in this area of trust. As you know, we've been looking at applying wisdom and looking at the book of Proverbs, and in Proverbs chapter 3, beginning at verse 5, he says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight." And I mentioned last week that this word trust means to rest securely in the arms of your parent. That's kind of, it gives us that kind of picture as a child is wrapped up into the arms of its mother or father. It's resting securely. And that's what we are called to do. We are called to trust, or to rest securely in the arms of our Lord. Trust in the Lord. And he even gives us the extent to which we should do that with all of our heart, not with a quarter of our heart or half of our heart, but with all of our heart, with all of our emotion, with all of our will engaged and intact, with all of our intellect as well. Trusting in the Lord is not just an intellectual pursuit, it's a heart pursuit as well. When I have the opportunity to marry someone, to marry a couple, they stand usually at this altar or some other altar. And what are they doing? They are giving themselves to each other. They are trusting in each other. And they're doing it with all of their heart, with every fabric of their being. That's what they're doing. Now, unfortunately, sometimes in human relationships, they fail, but not in God's relationship. And so we are called to trust in the Lord with all of our heart. We are called to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind, with all of our strength. And we are called to love our neighbor as ourselves in the same way. And so the Lord challenges us, calls us, commands us to take everything we have and trust, rest securely in Him. And it says that He, in all your ways, lean not on your own understanding. In other words, do not rest in your own wisdom, but in all your ways, acknowledge Him, bring Him into the equation. Acknowledge Him in prayer, in your testimonies, in wisdom and direction, and He will make your path straight. So we're called to trust, to rest in Him. Now last week, I shared some things out of this passage that I think we are called to do. We are called to trust the Lord in wisdom. We do not lean on our own understanding. We trust in Him. By the way, I don't think there's a PowerPoint because I might have messed it up. So don't look for the PowerPoint, although I was, because I was wondering if it was there. We are called to trust in Him. Okay. You know, I threw my back out, so it hurts to do that. I remember, you know, one time I saw a snake. And I was scared to death, and I went in crying and screaming and crying to tell my mom. And my mom sat and listened to me, and she says, "Let's go see the snake." And I brought her out to see the snake. It wasn't there. So I'm just, okay, get it? It wasn't there. Okay, forget it, you guys. You guys got to wake up, man. Huh? Anyway, so we're called to trust Him for wisdom. You know, we look to His word for wisdom. We look for understanding and for guidance. We do not lean on our own understanding because we know that there is a way that seemeth right unto man, but therein is the way to death. You know, we trust in our own wisdom. It'll take us down the wrong road. We trust in Him with our finances. We honor the Lord with the first fruits of our labor. And so we honor Him, we worship Him, we trust Him to provide for us. We trust Him in our finances. We even trust Him when we are being disciplined, because sometimes that happens. Verse 11, "My son, do not despise the Lord's discipline, or do not resent His rebuke, because the Lord disciplines those He loves as a father, the son He delights in." And so, you know, what's kind of takes me back in that is part of being a child is being disciplined. And so if you're a child of God, there's probably a time when the Lord's going to discipline you. Kids, for those of you who are here, I'm not asking you to share this, but can you think of a time when your parents had to discipline you? Now, yeah, raise your hand, go ahead, no. Can you think of a time when your parents had to discipline you? It didn't mean that they didn't love you. It meant that they do love you. That is a sign of their love for you, that they care so much, they are willing to risk their love, risk their friendship with you to guide you and direct you in the proper way. Because ultimately, your parent is not your best friend. They're not just supposed to give you everything you want. They're not Santa Claus. They're your parents. And so sometimes your parents discipline you. Well, adults, is it any different for us that every once in a while, because of God's great love for you, He disciplines you? So when you find yourself in that spot of being disciplined, do not despise the Lord. Do not grow bitter against Him. Don't get angry with Him. Because the Lord's disciplines, He disciplines those He loves. And lastly, I'm not sure if I really mentioned it much, but we can talk about it later, is we need to trust Him for salvation. But let me broaden this a little bit. We trust Him for deliverance. We simply trust Him to deliver us, because every once in a while, we need God's hand to deliver us. It says in verse 21 of Proverbs chapter 3, "My son, preserve sound judgment and discernment. Do not let them out of your sight. They will be life for you, an ornament to grace your neck. Then you will go on your way in safety, and your foot will not stumble. When you lie down, you will not be afraid. When you lie down, your sleep will be sweet. Have no fear of sudden disaster or of the ruin that overtakes the wicked, for the Lord will be your confidence and will keep your foot from being snared." You see, the Lord is your confidence. He is your deliverer. You look to Him for deliverance. And so, yes, at a very elementary way, we look to Him to save us from our sin. I mean, that is first and foremost. God in heaven, deliver me from my wicked, rebellious self. I need your help. But, you know, I mean, we can also turn to Him and ask for deliverance in other areas as well. "Dear God, I really messed up my finances. Will you please bail me out? I need your help. Lord, I really messed up this relationship. Man, I said the wrong thing. I'm not going to say what I said or whatever, you know. But Lord, help me. Fix this relationship for me." Can you think of some areas in your life where, for lack of a better term, you really messed up? Our God is a God of deliverance. He can deliver you from the foe. There are times, there are times when I got to go back to the Lord and say, "God in heaven, I messed up. I really messed up. Help me." Have you ever, help me out. Have you ever had to do that before? Raise your hand. I mean, honestly. You know, it was 7 o'clock at night in Kenya, right? We have all of our bags packed. The taxi comes, and we're just about ready to take our bags and throw them into the bus that we were going to take. And I figure, like a good husband, I'm going to call my wife and let her know, "Honey, we're on our way. We're leaving here pretty soon." And she said, "Aren't you on your way back to the church?" I said, "No. We are just leaving for the airport in Kenya." And she said, "Do you have something mixed up?" And I said, "No, I don't have anything mixed up." And she says, "Well, okay." And we got off the phone, and I said to Pastor Peter, "Peter, what day is today?" And he said, "December 13th. And I said, "Well, but the date is right. We're supposed to leave December 13th. We're supposed to leave at 12 a.m. 12 a.m. on December 13th. And so now, here we are in Kenya. We have missed our flight. And I had to quickly remind the team that they had the itinerary too. And I called the airline because I am the team leader or whatever. I called the airline and they said, "Well, sir, I'm sorry, you're gonna have to pay full price back home." Full price? Yes, approximately $1,800 per person. Now, what did I do? God in heaven, will you bail me out? I messed up bad. I mean real bad. I know I've shared this story with you before, but God in heaven help. You don't think I was praying then? I was praying. Our God is a God of deliverance. So yes, so I called the airline and our travel agent, and she said, "Let me do some work on your behalf." And so finally they called us back and they said, "Look, we'll get you home for $450 per person each." And so that's all we needed to pay, because I know each person had to pay it. But I saw that as God's deliverance. And on top of that, we got to stay 2 extra days. It was beautiful sunshine, 80-degree day. It was gorgeous. But Lord, God in heaven, thank you. Now, I'm telling you this because you know something? God can deliver you. I don't know what your circumstances in life are. I don't know where you find yourself. But God can deliver you if you turn to Him. He is a living God. So you can trust Him. Now, really, honestly, that was just review. When I began thinking about this, I'm going to start my series with money next week. And I was really going to start my series of money this week. But given the fact that we have a business meeting, I wanted to step back and look a little bit. And it was just kind of burning in my heart, you know, and sometimes, you know, you're typing out this message, but something else is ringing in your ear. And so I just wanted to ask this, simply this. How do we trust the Lord as a local church? In what areas of Grace Fellowship, where do we need to trust the Lord? Where do we need to trust Him in the church? Not only, I'm not saying the larger evangelical church, I'm talking about this church, this body, today. What are some of the areas that we need to trust Him in? So, this is not a State of the Union kind of address. It's just areas that I believe that we just need to trust Him. And so I wanted to speak to that this morning. First, I believe that we need to trust Him for the fruitfulness in ministries that already exist. You see, we need to trust Him that our ministries bear fruit. Whether it be Sunday school, whether it be pioneer clubs, whether it be children's church, whether it be adult small groups, whether it be youth ministries, whether it be outreaches, whether it be men's ministries, women's ministries, whatever ministries exist. We need to trust Him that God, through all of those efforts, will bear fruit. Paul wrote to the Colossians in chapter 1, verse 6, and he simply said this: all over the world, this gospel is bearing fruit and growing, just as it has been doing among you since the day you heard it and understood God's grace in all of its truth. And so it's my prayer that we learn to trust Him, and we learn to trust that the gospel of Jesus Christ will bear fruit in the ministries of this church. I pray that young people would come to know Christ. I pray that teenagers would come to know Christ, that young adults would come to know Christ, that older adults would come to know the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. I pray that, and my hope is that the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ will bear fruit in the ministries of this church. That means that we need to bring the gospel to bear. We shouldn't just meet to meet, although sometimes that's good too. But we always need to bring the gospel to bear on the situation. I also pray that not only will there be fruit born in this church through its ministries, but in your personal lives as well. Again, in Colossians, Colossians chapter 1, verse 10. He said this: and we pray this, Paul wrote to the Colossians, and he said, and we pray this, that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and may please Him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to His glorious might, so that you might have great endurance and patience and joy, and joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the kingdom of light. For He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son He loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. And so now here Paul prays that they, the Colossians, would bear fruit in every good work. And so we need to trust that the Lord will bring fruit out of our lives too, out of our own personal lives. What does that fruit look like? I think that fruit looks like obedience to God's word. I think it looks like that you would be a person of prayer, trusting the Lord in prayer. It would look like if you bore fruit, you would be growing in your love for God. If you bore fruit, you'd be working at growing in your love for others. And sometimes that's work, right? Bear with one another in love. It's not easy. But that you would be growing fruit personally. And so let me ask the simple application question: are you bearing fruit? As John tells us, without Him, you cannot do anything. Are you bearing fruit? And so maybe if you are not, then maybe you need to step back and kind of reevaluate the priorities of your life. Are you too busy? Are you preoccupied with things that you need to set aside? Do you need to join a small group? Or, you know, sometimes you just simply need to serve because you're soaking it in, but you're not giving it out. Are you bearing fruit? And in all love, don't lay that on the pastor. I can't tell you how many pastors I've heard, you know, said, well, I'm not growing, Pastor. You know, God has given you His wisdom to soak in, to read, to digest, to memorize, to obey. You have been given everything you need for life and for godliness. Use it. Simply use it. And so my prayer is that we will trust Him to bear fruit in the ministries that already exist. You know, one way you can be sure that you will bear fruit is just simply this, is always use God's word. Just always use God's word. Can I just suggest that in all of the small groups, even if you're doing a book study from an author, always bring God's word to bear, because He promises that His word will not return void. It will accomplish what it is set forth to do. So Paul wrote to the Corinthians in chapter 15, verse 58, and as we serve and we bring God's word to bear, he said this, therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. So here's the cool thing, is as you grow and as you serve, it will bear fruit, because God has promised it will bear fruit. It will bear fruit. You just have to trust that it's happening. And sometimes you don't see the result until eternity. I think I told you guys I used to be a youth pastor. And so we had this one young man who was a real pain in the neck, okay? He was a pain. And he was rebellious, active, kind of a good kid, but always getting in the middle of things. So one day, I took him for a camp out. And what he did is he put firecrackers in the fire. Right? But it sounds like somebody else I know who would do this, but I'm not saying who. So it's not me. So what happens? They didn't go off. Poor kid, must have been disappointing. You know, it must have been. So what happened is Pastor Bob went to put out the fire because we're going to go home pretty soon. Yay! And I stirred up the fire. And all the fire, I was bending down into the fire to do it, and the firecrackers went off in my face. I mean, the red coals, everything. Maybe I can use somebody. I grabbed that kid by the neck. Now, he did get a lot bigger than me, a lot bigger. But I took him, I raised him up, and I said, I have had it with you. I was so mad. Please don't tell my other church that, you know. So anyway. And, you know, this is the way he was. He's like this all the time, you know. About 3 years ago, I was sitting up in my office studying, and I got a phone call from Asia. And I thought, what's this? And I said, hello, who's this? He said, "Pastor Bob, it's Joel." "Joel? Joel, the Joel?" His name was Joel. He said, "I want to apologize to you. I was sometimes such a jerk. I know I created a lot of trouble for you, but I often think about you, and I want to apologize to you." I said, "Joel, where are you calling from?" He says, "Asia." I said, "What are you doing in Asia?" He says, "Well, I'm an assistant director to the Joyce Myers Ministry, and I'm in charge of distributing all the Samaritan purse boxes as part of a conglomerate." That was his deal. He was in charge of distributing the Samaritan purse boxes, and he also worked with Joyce Meyer Ministries in Asia. So here now this kid is in Asia, and he's doing the work of the Lord. Now, you know, I guess I could have quit thinking that, you know something? My ministry is not making any difference in this kid's life. And yet, somehow, by God's grace, it bore fruit. Now, I know that a lot had to do with other people as well. But when we minister and we serve, we trust that God's going to bring some fruit out of that. Well, that was longer than I thought. The next thing that I'd like to share is this, that we need to trust the Lord for a new generation of leaders. We need to trust the Lord for a new generation of leaders. What makes this so hard is that we are not a church, a gathering of people with a building plopped in the middle of a college town like in Northampton, Massachusetts. We don't have young college kids walking the streets all around us. As a matter of fact, if you want to come to this building, you're going to have to be able to at least drive or have somebody drive you. Have to admit, we're not the style of ministry that would attract a ton of college kids and young adults, I think. I have to say that. I mean, that's just really the way it is. I don't know what style that is sometimes, but I'm just saying that not necessarily that kind of style. Sometimes, you know, we do, you know, the old hymns, and sometimes we do Gaither, and sometimes we do the contemporary hymns, and, you know, we don't have strobe lights going on in here, and, you know, we didn't paint the walls black or anything like that, and we're just a typical kind of style New England church. But there are some things that we can do. And I recognize that, yeah, man, that's the way it is. But there are some things that we can do as we trust the Lord in this area, is that we can be inviters. You know, I'm so thankful for every one of you here. Every one of you. And yet, sometimes my heart gets sad because I feel like and I think Bob Williams understands this because he was the pastor before me. After years of preaching up here, you would hope that this church would double in size, triple in size, not because of my preaching, just because of our outreach. And we should have, at least. But we haven't. And I think, you know, maybe it is because of the preaching. But one aspect is we need to be inviters. You know, Jesus taught his disciples to go invite. They were inviters. As part of our DNA, we need to always be inviting people to the Savior. Not to Pastor Bob, but to the Savior. And this is his body right here. We are the body of Christ. You want a visible representation of what Christ looks like, come see the body, and come see the body worship and recognize his lordship and love him and serve him. And so we always need to be inviters, not only people who are older, but people who are younger as well. We need to be inviters. There absolutely needs to be training and a culture of training. And along with that, community. Because nothing happens unless there's community. If we just become a church of a group of people who happen to come in here on Sunday and we leave, and some of us are just there, just like that, we really will never grow to our full potential, and this church will really never be all that God calls us to be. There needs to be community, and that's why we host small groups and do youth groups. I want you to listen to Titus chapter 2, and I don't know how much of it I'll read, but just listen to this, because this is the kind of environment that God calls us to, all right? And before I read it, notice how there are older people who are setting themselves up as examples and are available to be an example. And notice there are others who need to be available to learn and to make time to learn. So Titus chapter 2, Paul wrote to Titus and he said, you must teach what is in accordance with sound doctrine. So sound doctrine, this church needs to be a place where sound doctrine is taught. And that's why, for example, you know, Rick Breckenridge, some of you don't know him, but many of you do. He taught through the doctrinal statement of the Evangelical Free Church. It wasn't really the free church. It was just Protestant good doctrine. It doesn't sound exciting, but it is what it is. It's doctrine. It's the essentials of the faith. You must teach what is in accordance with sound doctrine. Teach the older men to be temperate, worthy of respect, self-controlled, sound in faith, in love and endurance. Now, wait a minute. Now, hold on. Did you say who he has to teach? He has to teach the older men to be temperate and the older men to be worthy of respect. I would have thought he would have said the younger men. But it starts with the older men. How old is old? I don't know, man. It ain't me. Teach the older men to be temperate. You know, I tell you what, I thought that in this Christian walk of mine, I thought that as I grew older in the Lord, I'd get more and more godly. Guys, do you find that to be the case? No. I am more short-tempered now than I have ever been. You crushed me once. And it's, you know, I mean, just the way it is. I used to look at my dad, and I know he wasn't a Christian per se. I'd say, Dad, what do you get so mad for? But now I know why. I'm getting there. I understand. I can give him a high five. But yeah, Dad, I understand why. You know, you just want things to go easy and smooth, and you don't want a lot of trouble. And besides that, you know, your back hurts, your feet hurts, you got acid reflux, you got a headache, you know, your sinuses are congested. You just fill it in. Toothache, you know, you've been going to the doctor, your mouth is impacted with gauze because of your root canal and all this stuff, man. It doesn't get easy, man. It gets harder as you get older. Of course you need to be temperate, worthy of respect, self-controlled, and sound in faith, in love, and in endurance. And I feel like if that's These are the areas sometimes, boy, I got to repent from and just be patient. Likewise, teach older women. I'm not pointing to Jane Mason, by the way. Teach older women, okay. Teach older women to be reverent in the way they live. To be reverent in the way they live. Not to be slanderous or addicted to much wine, but to teach what is good. Do you notice that the older women are to teach what is good? Ladies, if you're older, and I don't know how much older is, you are to be a teacher, to teach what is good. Then they can train the younger women. And so now for those of you who are younger, you need to make yourself available to the older ladies. Then they can train the younger women. You know, this training that takes place does not happen when there is no community, when there is no relationship. Then they can train the younger women to love their husbands and children. That's interesting. To love their husbands and their children, as if they wouldn't love their children. But hey, sometimes, let's face it, parents. Yeah, I know you love your children. I know that. Okay. To be self-controlled and pure. To be busy at home. To be kind. Ladies, you are to be kind. To be subject to their husbands, so that no one will malign the word of God. But husbands, you need to be, remember, you need to be temperate, worthy of respect, self-controlled, sound in faith, in love, and endurance. It'll make it easy for your wife to love you then. Verse 6. Yeah, I have at least till 1 o'clock, right? Similarly, encourage young men to be self-controlled. In everything, set them an example by doing what is good. Now he's still talking to the men, right? Now, set them an example to what is good. In your teaching, show integrity, seriousness. I guess I have to work on that a little more. In soundness of speech that cannot be condemned, so that those who oppose you may be ashamed because they have nothing bad to say about us. You see, there is an exchange here that Titus is not an old guy. He is to teach the older men. He's to teach the older women. The older men are to set an example for the younger men. The older women are to set an example and to teach the younger women. You see, in the local body of Christ, there is an environment of learning and teaching and growing and modeling. And you want to know how to reach a new generation, open up your life. Invite younger people in. We employ a youth pastor, but it shouldn't rely on him. Every one of you should have a youth group in your house. I'm just kidding, but I'm not. And you know, for some of you, you just moved into the area and you need to begin to make inroads into people's lives. Understand all of that. But it's a give and take relationship, and that's how, through the body of Christ, new leadership and a new generation of leaders develop. He even says in verse 9, teach slaves to be subject to their masters in everything, to try to please them and not talk back to them. Do not steal from them, but show that they can be fully trusted, so that in every way they will make the teaching about God our Savior attractive. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. It teaches us, see now here, God is teaching all of us. It's teaching all of us. God's grace is teaching all of us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, godly lives in this present age while we wait for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. These things, then, are the things, Timothy or Titus, you should teach, encourage, and rebuke with all authority. Do not let anyone despise you. Or he said to Timothy, do not let anybody look down at you because you are young. You see, if we are going to raise up a new generation of leaders, then we need to open up our lives. We need to be inviters, and we need to invite people into our lives. It's not going to happen just through a church program. It's not going to happen because you relied on the pastor to send somebody your way. This is your deal. This is your responsibility. Another way, or another thing that we need to think about when we talk about this new generation of leaders, and I'll move quicker here, is just simply this. For those of you who are younger, and again, I don't know what that is, but for those of you who are younger, you have to take ownership in this church, in this local church. We are counting on you to take ownership of this local church. We need you. If I had my way, the elder board would be, and every board would have a mixture of not only, you know, like with the elders, for example, we try to have a mixture of young men and young older men. And I think that is important. But how come I don't see any 20-year-olds on the deacon board? Or how come we don't see very many young adults serving on committees? Now, I'm not saying that's the only place you can serve Christ. I'm just saying that we need for you to take ownership of this church. And that's why I'm so thankful for you teenagers who are serving, like, for example, in pioneer clubs and serving in different areas of the church. It's important, man. That's what it's about. Paul wrote to the Corinthians and he said, we who are many are one body. And that was a slogan of this church, for a motto of this church for many years. We who are one, we are one body. There is unity. It's not your church or their church or the pastor's church. It's your church. This place stands or falls by the grace of God, by what you do and how you choose to serve and honor the Lord Jesus Christ. Forget about the building. And somehow we need to figure out ways to just get rid of this, I guess you call it a consumer mentality that many people walk into the church with. And, you know, what will this church do for me? What will this church do for my children? What will, you know, you just fill in the blank. Many people, our culture has adopted kind of a consumer mentality, even when it comes to churches. My friends, it should be no surprise to you that we need to trust the Lord, and we need help. We need help in all areas. And you know something? I don't know all of your skills. Yes, when you become a member, I have you fill out a skill survey sheet, and we look at that. But you know, you have skills and talents that probably should come to bear and you've been hiding it. Maybe you're a musician. Man, we need a drummer. We need a drummer. God took one drummer out of here, Pastor Paul. I can't keep playing drums every week. I love playing drums. We need a drummer. We need musicians. We need guitar players. We need singers. We need administrators. We need teachers. We need you. We need you. Lastly, let me throw this out. We need to trust him for new opportunities. Listen to some of these verses. 1 Corinthians 16:12. Now about our brother Apollos, Paul wrote, he says, I strongly urge him to go with you to the brothers. He was quite unwilling to go now, but he will go when he has the opportunity. So why am I reading that? Because there are times when there is an opportunity to serve, and there are times when there is not. And we all have to recognize that. There are times when there is no opportunity, for whatever reason. Like, you know, it's hard to serve in the nursery when you know, you got, let's say, elementary kids. Because you know that, you know that you have to be here for them. But you want to serve there, but you have to be in here for them. I know what that's like because kind of I'm there too. You want to help with children's church, but it's tough because you have to bring them along with you. So there are seasons and times for ministry in our lives. But there are opportunities that God provides. Paul wrote to the Galatians and he said this, therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of God. You see, God will place in your lap opportunities. You can take advantage of it or not. But when you take advantage of it, God will do great things. Paul wrote to the Ephesians, make the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Paul wrote to the Philippians, I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. You see, there are opportunities, and then sometimes there are not opportunities. But when those opportunities come, you got to take advantage of them. I can think even back, you know, in the past few years of this church, thinking of opportunities that we almost missed in big time kind of ways. For example, the opportunity to go to Kenya. I remember the first trip we put together to go to Kenya. The budget wasn't doing well. Giving wasn't exceedingly high. There were fiscal constraints. There were churches being blown up by bombs in Kenya. And it seemed like, when you step back, it seemed like, no, we shouldn't do this. Not now. There are a bunch of reasons, good reasons, why not to take advantage of the opportunity. But I'm so glad we did. Because now we get to support an orphanage. When we were in Kenya, you know, and we missed that airline ticket, we missed that airline flight, we had the opportunity to meet with Pastor James. I'm so glad we did. We could have stayed back inside of the nice Rift Valley school with wire all around and said, we're going to stay safe right here instead of venture out beyond the walls. But we ventured out beyond the walls, and we met with Pastor James, and we talked about what could be as we sat and dreamed about meeting the needs of these street children. Opportunities. Some of us went to Kiev and visited with the Logos Center, and there we got to minister in cool ways. But the neat thing is that even when we came back, the church not only supports Pam DeAndre, but supports the Logos Center, which now has become a place of a housing for refugees from this whole debacle with Russia. Now a whole bunch of Ukrainian refugees are now living there, and they're experiencing the gospel of Jesus Christ in living color. And you have a part of that because we took advantage of an opportunity. And so we need to trust the Lord for future opportunities. And what those opportunities will be, I don't know. I wish I could tell you. I know some of them I wish. I mean, I know that we're talking about planting a church. There is a church plant. And then you have that. But then, man, there's other things. I would love, again, I'll just voice this. I'd love to see support groups. I'd love to be able to see groups where people can come with problems and dependencies. They can come and truly share their problems and their concerns and their pain. I would love to see groups for those who are wrapped up in pornography and for those who are addicted to drinking or to drugs. I'd love to see a support group for those who are going through a divorce. God in heaven, please bring these things about. But we just struggle with staffing Sunday school. Need to trust that God will bring new people on board and He'll do great things. And finally, I just say this, that we need to trust Him for the finances of this church. We simply need to trust Him. A pastor one day said to his congregation, brothers and sisters, is a pastor in an urban setting, and he said, brothers and sisters, this church, it's crawling, but we got to walk. We got to walk with the Lord. We got to walk. And the congregation said, pastor, let's walk. He says, no, brothers and sisters, we need to run. We need to run for the Lord. And the congregation came back and said, pastor, we need to run. Let us run. He said, brothers and sisters, we got to fly, man. We got to fly for the Lord. And the congregation said, let us fly. Let us fly. And then he said, but brothers and sisters, if we're going to fly, we need some money. And the congregation said, let us crawl. Let us crawl. There are times when we need to take our finances and use them for God's work. We're still paying a mortgage. We employ two families full time. That's a ministry to those families. We employ a couple to clean the church. That's a ministry to them. We employ a secretary to help with the administrative needs of the church. That's a ministry to that family. We support 10 missionaries. That's an incredible opportunity to serve them. We support the Logos Center in Kiev. What an opportunity there. We support Brook of Hope Orphanage in Kenya. What an opportunity there. These are just not burdens on the church, my friend. These are opportunities for ministry, and we got to continue to take advantage of them. We have the opportunity to help contractors and employers and piano tuners and copying repairmen support their family. Is that not important before the eyes of God? Yes. We have the opportunity to support guys who come in and fill up the oil tank. They get the opportunity to take care of and supply their care for their family. And yet I recognize that the financial stability of this church rests on the financial stability of your own family. And that's why we need to have something like peace, financial freedom here, Dave Ramsey stuff, or Crown Financial, something to help people with their finances. Because a ton of us are struggling, and I don't see the economy getting any better that way. The government, last thing the government wants to do is have you save. They do not want you to save. They want you, your money in the economy, working in the economy, but they don't want you to save. Nehemiah was told to build a wall, or he set off. He had this opportunity to build the wall of Jerusalem. And there were some naysayers, Sanballat and Tobiah. And so listen to this passage. It says, but when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Amorite, servant and Geshem the Arab heard of it, okay, that was a lot to say, they jeered at us and despised us and said, what is this thing that you are doing? Are you rebelling against the king? Then I replied, this is what Nehemiah replied. He said, the God of heaven will make us prosper, and we, his servants, will arise and build. But you have no portion or right or claim in Jerusalem. My friends, we will learn to trust the Lord Jesus Christ. And the God of heaven, he will make us prosper. And we will arise and we will build. Amen? Amen. And so we choose to trust in the Lord. And as we choose to trust in the Lord, we will bring him into the equation. We will acknowledge him. And by God's grace, he will make our path straight. Thank you. Let me pray. God in heaven, thank you for the people's willingness to sit and listen. And God in heaven, I pray that you will help us to be the people that you've called us to be, who are on mission for Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, thank you. Amen. I think we have just a closing song. You can stand.
Shall come with shout of acclamation.
To him be the glory and the honor in the church forever and ever. Amen. I want to invite you to our